Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. We are about to begin our session titled Words and Images of the Day. The speakers are Olivier Truck, Barkha Dutt, Farhan Bukhari and Fasi Ahmed.
In that order.
The moderator for this session will be Ghazi Salahuddin. Please switch off your mobile phones or put them on silent mode. There will be a question and answer session at the end of the discussion. And we would appreciate if complete silence is observed while the session is in progress. Ghazi Salahuddin is a senior journalist, writer, literary figure and political analyst. Bas itna to, aur nahi bol.
Thank you so much. Let's begin the session. And if you are wondering what this title of the session means, words and images of the day, then you are not alone. Barkha should be interested in this session because we had this session earlier in the day in which she made the observation that in the media, things are very simplistic and binary view, and there is no, the complexity of issues is not explored. So we got it for you, Barkha. We have some complexity here. So let me first introduce our panelist, Mr. Olivier Truck.
Almost.
Got it right. Okay.
Well, yes, right. It's better and better.
He's a very prominent French journalist based in Sweden. Then, Barkha Dutt, Hamari Apni.
Thank you.
Farhan Bukhari is a journalist and works for the Financial Post and has been associated with many foreign publications and news agencies.
Financial Times.
FT. FT should have been. Huh. So, to begin with it, I think since our panel consists of journalists, so it has to be about journalism. How does journalism portray, reflect, explore images of the day? And that is that it's the task, the assignment of the media to explore the reality of the situation as it exists. And it does that on a daily basis with the breaking news syndrome. But then we have to see how well does it reflect the reality on the ground? How well does it analyze that reality? How well does it understand the events that are taking place? So, because generally we feel, and at least, and Barkha would agree, and Farhan Bukhari would agree, and please agree with both of them, that the media...
You have to agree with us.
That the media in at least Pakistan and to a large extent in India has not really been the part of the solution, and it is increasingly becoming a part of the problem. The way it trivializes, scandalizes, the way it looks at the sensational aspects of it, the way it polarizes society. So that's the general feeling. But Olivier comes from another background, and perhaps it will be interesting for us to hear what he has to say on this.
So you mean that the European newspapers don't trivialize and don't don't scandalize?
Do all of them do all?
I was supposed to agree about what that too.
Yes.
No, of course they do also, and I don't know whether they are part of the problem, as you said, like in Pakistan and India. But I think that there is a huge diversity of newspapers and magazines in France, when I come from, and in Sweden, where I'm working, where I've been working in the past 20 years as a correspondent. Excuse me. here. Can you hear me now? Okay. Thank you. Quite impressive now. I'm working for a daily newspaper which is called Le Monde, which is tried to be a very serious newspaper, quite boring, and which is very good for a newspaper. Yes. To be boring, because you have to be, it's a very serious stuff. Because as you said, you have to give the right tools to the readers if they want to understand the situation. But even for a newspaper like Le Monde, which is very, we try to be as neutral as possible. I will not try to define neutrality, yes. but we get attacked all the time, because yes. we are accused to be a partisan on the left, on the right, and so on and so on. Sometimes we are accused to be criminalizing the situation and so on. So, and it's even worse now with internet, because we are, as newspapers, we have less and less readers on the print, but more and more readers on the internet. And then yes. the comments on the internet are more part of the problem than the newspaper itself.
But the social media, or
yeah, the social media. I mean, you know, when you publish an article on the internet on Le Monde's website, then the readers can comment, and then often I can see that part of the problem is in the comments line.
Baka, we have come to social media.
Well, I already spoke a lot about that in the morning.
Yes. But we have shuffled the audience.
Okay, for those who haven't heard me in the morning, I was talking about how social media has created a reductionist narrative, and you know, people today are asked to take sides either in ideological camps or political camps. Nuance and complexity is shrinking, and when people can't label you, you tend to be called biased from all sides. You know, and because people want to slot you easily, and a lot of people who don't have thick skins, wo thoda dar jate hain, because there's so much venom and poison and toxicity on social media that people get, people feel the pressure to take positions that they think will make them popular. And I always say that a journalist's job is not to be popular. A lot of young people in India ask me, you know, what does it take to be a journalist? And my answer is always a willingness to be unpopular. Too many journalists, I think, today are seeking popularity. And I think social media is a syndrome of that, because there's an instant feedback, and you want to be liked. And it's a big human failing. We all have it. We all want to be liked. But as journalists, you have to be willing to be disliked. But one of the words that Olivier used that struck me as very important is the word boring. People like me and my channel, we suffer from this label in India, because we are today dealing with a media environment where a lot of you must have heard of Noam Chomsky. Noam Chomsky had a phrase called manufacturing consent. And I like to say that Chomsky has been turned on his head, and now it's become all about manufacturing dissent. And there are a number of TV channels today where it's just this dialectics of artificial confrontation. So you put people, you choose extreme voices deliberately, you set them off against each other, they shout a lot, people think it's absurd, but they're entertained by it, then they crib about it later, but they watch it. And there are those of us who are more sober, who are more complex, who are more nuanced, and we're called boring. And I think that this word boring today has really come to be a challenge for those of us who want to be serious. We don't want to be theatrical. We don't want to be entertainers. That's not what I became a journalist for. But we're really dealing, and main yahan bhi dekhti hun, main Pakistan television channels dekhti hun. Mujhe lagta hai ki ye trend yahan bhi aa chuka hai. This trend has come here as well.
Nahi, yahan to bahut tezi se aaya hai. Bahut gehra hai.
Ye ek crisis hai. This is a crisis for journalism. That news has become theater.
Yes. Oh yes. News has become theater.
Aapko drama dekhna hai, to aap news kyun dekhte hain? It's a real crisis for old-style journalists like me. I'm hearing him say this.
Yes.
Today, if I saw television channels and I was 16 years old, I would not want to become a journalist.
No, I think if you stop watching news on news channels, I think you'll be less...
No, sir, sare mediums mein ye ho raha hai. Akhbaron mein bhi pressure hai. There's pressure on the print medium, social media, certainly. There's a pressure on all mediums today. to be inflammatory, to be provocative. Now you look at the online world. How do you measure the success of a website? You measure the success of a website based on the number of hits an article gets. The number of hits an article gets tends to be on how outrageous it's going to be. So outrageousness, provocativeness, a deliberate taking of a position you may not even believe because it may get you the eyeballs. Huh. This is a real crisis for our profession today. Huh. And it's globally. This is India, Pakistan, it's globally. I think this is a global crisis. Yes, mm-hmm. yes.
If we move to Farhan, what does one do about it?
Well, thank you, hey. Vaisab. I've just come back from a trip to Balochistan. Hmm. And like my previous trips to Balochistan, this time around, it's well.
There is a mic. Okay.
Is this better?
Yes.
Like my previous trips to Balochistan, I heard number of people in Quetta and other places complaining ke sahab aapke jo talk shows hain wo yahan kyun nahi aate. The reason why talk shows don't go to Balochistan is because this dreadful mechanism, and I do call it dreadful, known as people's meter, which is used for
TRPs.
Quote unquote TRP. Ratings purposes, does not have an existence in Balochistan. And therefore, the discussions on Balochistan are typically hosted from Karachi or Lahore or Islamabad for that reason. This is only one example of that environment in which we live, in which commercialism is so much a driving force, and ratings, which is the most important thing to me, is that people, how many people, اپنے کیبل آپریٹرز کے ذریعے کسی ایک چینل کو یا کسی ایک پروگرام کو کسی ایک وقت پہ دیکھتے ہیں اس کے نتیجے میں کوالٹی ڈیفینیٹلی ڈیکلائن پہ ہے اور سیریس جرنلزم از بیڈلی کمپرومائزڈ آئی تھنک یو کین جسٹ کاؤنٹ بیئرلی آن یور فنگر ٹپس دا نمبر آف آؤٹ لیٹس ان پاکستان وچ آر اسٹل ڈوئنگ سیریس جرنلزم. Dawn, the newspaper, is my first pick of the day because Dawn still has quality to offer of the kind that I would like to read early in the morning. So this is the downside risk, and certainly is something that I am very worried about. The other side, of course, is that when I stepped into journalism, which was almost 35 years ago, Pakistan lived in a very different environment. One of the darkest chapters in Pakistan's history, the 1980s. And I still remember that in 84, when I left Pakistan to go abroad for higher studies, I actually had to take an NOC from the government's Ministry of Education because I had been warned that I could be stopped at the airport, given that my editor had received complaints on some of my activities in the previous 1 year. Now, you look at that background and you ask yourself, yaar, ye to Pakistan tha hi nahi. Pakistan wahan se nikal ke aaj ek dusri taraf chala gaya hai. Log bahut bolte hain, kabhi itna zyada bolte hain aur itna oot patang bolte hain ki wo aap TV channel band karne ko dil chahta hai ya TV channel badalne ko dil chahta hai because it's completely unregulated. So the question for me is that have we come to a point in time where some sensible regulation has to be put in place. Now, I have to be very careful as a journalist because I've always believed, never. And I can see.
I would rather live with the churn of our industry than ever give governments in any country the space to get into our
But then
you cannot trust politicians in the media.
The question is,
there is the concept of self-regulation.
Hamare hai na. Hai. Lekin wo yahan pe nahi hai. And that was exactly the next point that I wanted to make. Can we look forward to a day where the self-regulation would become sensible enough, responsible enough to take care of some of these excesses? I mean, content-wise, sometimes, for example, it happens all the time that there is coverage of people targeting some people, in which it's the whole story is one-sided. The reporter and the news organization have not even cared to reach out to the person and given them an opportunity right of response, which in my book and certainly Barkha's book should be a fundamental and cardinal principle. Wo nahi ho raha. Sawal ye hai ki ye jis environment mein hum rehte hain, isko badalne ke liye aur us behtar fiza mein jaane ke liye hame kya karne ki zarurat hai. And that I think is one of the biggest challenges faced by Pakistan journalism.
I mean, we can be joint anchors of this program.
Achha, okay. Joint four anchors. Chances are we won't agree on anything. Wo hamari profession ki ek khasiyat hai. No, I just want to say that to give you an understanding of the Indian environment, we do have a self-regulating body that was actually headed by a former justice of the Supreme Court. So we do have a self-regulation court. But I want to say something a little controversial here. Jahan hum log jaate hain, India mein bhi aur yahan pe bhi, mujhe maloom hai ki aap logon ke bhi ye sawal honge, bahut media bashing hoti hai. A lot of people say, oh, you people just want to, you know, you're not interested in serious news. You just have these shouting matches. It's become a kind of absurdist drama. And I would agree with all of that. But then I think you as viewers and consumers of news also have to reflect on why you are making these products successful. Because bar bar hame bola jata hai that you are ratings hunters. But what is a TRP? What is a people's meter? It's all of you. Now, one very curious phenomenon we see in India is that we see people really, you know, moaning and criticizing these channels, which are these, you know, very, very, I would say, often warmongering, often simplistic, hashtag driven, not very intelligent, there's no nuance, no complexity, but because they're entertaining, because usme tamasha hota hai, people tend to gravitate to watch the tamasha, then they want to discuss the tamasha over the dinner table, then they want to, you know, even if you're making fun of that channel, or you are still watching it. Because you're still watching it, you're giving that channel an advantage, you're allowing that kind of journalism to define the market. So jab aap log kehte hain humse ki aap log is tarah ki news kyun karte hain, to aapko bhi reflect karna hoga ki aap is tarah ki news kyun dekhte hain.
Ye sahi hai.
Valid point.
That's the point. Let's come to Olivia. Olivia, you are the only person among the panelists who is also a creative writer, who have written novels. I sometimes think that perhaps a novelist or a poet is better able to understand the situation that exists than a journalist. Would you agree with it?
I'm not sure, but it's an interesting idea. I mean, as a novelist, you get much more room.
Yes.
To go into details, to go into nuances, to go into complexity, what you were talking about in the beginning, that which is very difficult often to do in a newspaper, but as a journalist, you only in principle deal with facts. You don't have to care so much about facts. In novel, even if my novels are very much based about documentation and about real stuff, but I think what a novel does allow is to go into the complexity of human beings.
Yes.
In how they think, what makes them to take a decision, which is often a big source of frustration as a journalist, because you get facts, you meet people, you make interviews, they tell you what they have to do to sell, even if it's politicians or whatever, or corporates, and then you have to deal with that. If you don't have so much time to investigate, you have to write an article which is based on, you know, vague sources. If you have a lot of time, if you are working in a newspaper, we gives you room to investigate, then it's okay. But even then, you can get completely manipulated, and you will never go into the mind of the
no,
people.
No, what I was suggesting was that perhaps a creative writer understands the reality better than someone who is looking for mere facts.
I mean, I'm not sure they understand better, but a journalist can only deal with facts. So even he can understand something, but he cannot write about it because he cannot prove it. And that's the limits of journalism. If you cannot prove it, you don't write it. A novelist don't have to prove it, so he can write and imagine and so on.
Baka, throughout the world, I mean, mainly in the West, we see the circulations of newspapers dwindling, and people
moving away from
the print media. But this, what I have read about India and China, it seems that only in China and India, the print media has stayed strong and has gained circulation.
Yes. That is true,
and why?
It's certainly true for newspapers in India. I think it has something to do with the scale of our market also. And the fact that a lot of people are now preferring to read and consume news also in their own languages. So our regional media is also very strong. In fact, some of our state-based newspapers are, I would say, much more influential than our national newspapers. Lekin jab log kehte hain that print is dying, mujhe lagta hai ki ye theek nahi hai. Mujhe lagta hai ki jo churn hum aaj dekh rahe hain, jab TV shuru hua tha, newspapers were forced to readapt themselves. Newspapers had to respond to the challenge of TV. TV was disruptive. Today, TV is being forced to adapt itself to the disruptive nature of social media and new technology. We are having to deal with the fact that anyone who has a mobile phone today and an internet account is a potential journalist. So mainstream media is being challenged like never before. And you know, hum apne bare mein sochte the ki hum gatekeepers hain, hum check karke aapko khabar dete hain. Today there is a churn because there is a democratization of news, there is a two-way dialogue. You can't stand today at a pulpit and lecture to people. Wo aapko wapis lecture karenge. So it's become a very cacophonic space. You know, for lack of a better word, it's a very noisy space. Kyunki mujhe lagta hai mainstream media ne abhi ye tay nahi kiya ki jo nayi technology hai, naya social media hai, isme hum apni relevance kaise banaye rakhe. Kyunki sach to ye, chahe ye Pakistan ho chahe India ho, jo khabar hai wo aapko apne phone pe subah mili jati hai. Jiske paas smartphone hai wo apna, aur aajkal sabke paas smartphone hai. So when you watch the 9 PM news, you're no longer coming to it to watch the news. You're coming to it for either analysis or opinion or to be provoked. So we also have to understand why our industry is changing.
Yes, but that originally should be the print media's task, to analyze, to go into the background, to provide deeper analysis.
And it still does. In many cases, I still see that. In many cases, newspapers that have not reinvented themselves, jiska front page, you see today, agar aapka front page is yesterday night's 9 PM news, if the newspaper's front page is what you have already seen on the night, on the nightly news before, you're irrelevant. A newspaper is under much more pressure today to break stories. Yes. Because the mere chronicling of news is already being done by other mediums.
So more investigative reporting, more analysis. Farhan, with your experience of, because you have a larger interest in print media, but of course, FT aside, how do you look at the Pakistani print media, and has it changed in the context of how it can, its capacity to analyze, to explore, to come out with investigative reporting?
Well, as I said earlier on, parts of it are trying to adjust, and as I said, I start my day with Dawn, first .com, and then the newspaper, and then I look at the news as well. And Dawn is certainly a very good example in our country. The big downside of Dawn is of course that it doesn't really have a competitor in its own class. But Dawn is one newspaper which I think is a very good example of adjusting to a new environment. Dawn, incidentally, is also the one paper which I think has done more to give opportunities to women journalists to be on the front lines than other newspapers across Pakistan. So, for example, I know of a couple of news organizations which have refused women journalists who wanted to go on certain stories because of quote-unquote concerns about their safety. Mm. Whereas in the case of Dawn, you have some very fine young girls who go off to remote places, and of course there are security mechanisms. You just deal with that, and you go and you do the story and you come back. So I think it's somewhat patchy. As far as the Urdu press is concerned, Jung, I think, still has a very large presence all across Pakistan, and it's a widely read newspaper. One time, this was many years ago, I was up at Saiful Muluk Lake in the north, and we went up there, and then we walked into a shop to have pakoda and chai.
And I asked them, ki ji aapka sabse pehle newspaper kaun sa aata hai? They understood I was interested. He said ki wo subah 9 baje jeep aati hai, usme sabse pehle hame jung milta hai. So in terms of the distribution, even around around Saiful Malook, which is really remote for people who may have been up there, jung is the way to go.
And you know, but our part of the world is we're a very political people. I think we're a very very political argumentative culture. Aap chote se chote gaon mein chale jaye to jo insaan padh sakta hai wo akhbar padh raha hai. So I think we are evolving in a different way. We are voracious consumers of news. We are extremely opinionated people. We like a good argument. So I think that there is no danger of news dying in our country. I think the danger is what are the principles by which we do news and what are the principles by which news is consumed. But there is an abiding interest in all things political.
Just two comments about what has been said. First, that's just talking about Le Monde, because it's a newspaper I know the best. The print audience has decreased extremely because of internet and so on. That's right. But our global audience, thanks to internet, thanks to the mobile, has increased.
I mean, the global audience of the print media,
of the mainstream print media, of Le Monde,
Le Monde as a newspaper,
I
think people here may not be aware that Le Monde is the newspaper of record in France.
But
it is an afternoon daily. It is an afternoon daily.
Yes. Today, I think we have a circulation of maybe 300,000. Issue, which is very little for a print, but with the internet and mobile and everything, and the tablets, we have between five and seven million readers a day, which we could never dream about for 20 years ago. So our audience is much bigger. And the second, talking about the what kind of news analysis newspaper has to bring. I've been a journalist for 30 years. I've been working both for daily newspaper and weekly news magazines. And what we see today with the pressure of the put by the internet of the print paper is that what the kind of analysis, the kind of articles which used to be published in the weekly newspapers for 20 years ago, now it's done by the daily newspapers because they have to bring this analysis not to be after, you know, because everything is already on the internet. So you have to bring something. It's every day. Le Monde, we are publishing a weekly news magazine every day. That's what we are doing with analysis and so on.
Because traditionally, a newspaper was meant for the city where it is published, or if it is a national newspaper. Now, if more people read it on internet, spread across the world, what is the influence of a newspaper? How does, what kind of change it can make? This is a question.
Well, I think that in our country, the net is still evolving because the penetration is not as deep as maybe parts of Europe or North America.
Can a newspaper, and that's what is expected of a newspaper or of a media.
Why should the impact of a newspaper change if you consume it on the internet instead of in?
No. For instance, all politics is local.
Right.
And the news has to be local in that sense. And if somebody in Spain is reading Le Monde, and the Le Monde is campaigning for something in Paris,
but
what does it mean?
But globalization and localization are parallel tracks of our world, right? So when the terror attacks happen in Paris, it is everybody's story. And when you tell a local story, you have to universalize it so that the whole world is interested. You see, this is the thing we have to talk about. When we talk about words or images, we became journalists because we were interested in the art of storytelling. We all tell stories in different ways, through fiction, through non-fiction, through interviews, through columns. Lekin aakhir mein wohi ek art hai, the art of storytelling. And you're a good artist if you can make the Paris terror attack and the sex ratio in India speak in the same way. to the same consumer.
But another
that tests your skill.
Yes,
but
with the kind of media coverage that these big events demand or get, does not the story itself change with the presence of the media?
It has, to some extent.
How, Farhan?
It has, but I think, you know, we need to step back a bit.
Yes.
Because what is journalism? Where did it start from? What we are talking about here are the tools that have evolved over the years, the internet being the latest one. But fundamentally, it's about content. It's about what you have to write and what you have to say and reliability. Because mind you, part of the problem with the social media is that there's a lot of stuff which is just not true, which is partially not true or just not true. I mean, there are blogs which come across my desk, especially on various politicians, and we try to check them out. Not every blog, but some of them. They are completely somebody's figment of somebody's imagination. So then, you know, it just gets back to writing reliably with a certain quality. And if you can do that, of course, people will respond to that.
Now shifting, I mean, to another issue. What is public service broadcasting? Is it something? Has it any potential to compensate for the excesses of the mainstream media?
It's interesting you say that. I mean, I'm not aware of how that works in India, but recently I was part of a discussion on public sector, public interest.
Yes.
Not public sector, but public interest broadcasting in our context. And somebody who's very senior in one of the TV channels said ki wo humne jab license diya tha tab wo koi commitments ki thi lekin uske baad kaun sochta hai wali baat wo unfortunately because again you know without necessarily arguing for the government to regulate but there should be some framework within which and it should be internal. It should be done by news organizations themselves.
I'd be very wary of that.
But Barkha, there's another issue there, which is that I've also seen in the last 20, 30 years, weakening of news editors, and
no,
I think
true.
That is part of the problem as well.
It's
which
the
then
same
takes
in India. The same in India. The editor has almost disappeared.
Well, the tyranny of the market, you know. People often ask you how often do politicians interfere in your story. In my experience, politicians have, mujhe 20 saal ho gaya. I don't know a politician who ever managed to get a story killed. But what does take stories off the pages, off prime time, is a calculation that your market is not interested in it. So actually, the market determines the content much more than any pressure from politicians. I will say that, in any vibrant democracy at least. That said, there is a problem that none of us have genuine public broadcasters. Our public broadcasters are not autonomous. They are not free from government control. We have not seen a BBC-like model in our part of the world, and I doubt we're going to see one either. And broadcasting faces a problem that newspapers and the internet doesn't, that it is prohibitively expensive. So there are only two ways to finance television news. One is the state, so you have Qatar financing Al Jazeera, or the license fees of BBC, or you have corporates. So, yehi do tarike hain finance karne ke liye. It does have its own consequence on content. I'm not going to deny that there is a market-driven orientation to content, and just like you say, Baluchistan doesn't make it to the news. Ham logon ko pucha jata hai ki hamare farmer suicides hain, wo kabhi prime time news pe nahi aate because you know, we've also become increasingly classist as societies. Our societies have become more unequal. Our viewers are not interested in this, so we tend to not tell those stories often enough. But I cannot agree again with you because this thing of codifying what is public interest is a little bit like defining what is national interest, is a little bit like defining what is nationalism, is a little bit like defining what is good, what is bad. I don't want to give any government the right to tell me what is appropriate for me as a journalist to do.
But suppose we define public interest broadcasting as broadcasting that is not controlled by commercial interests.
So, who will give the money? And if the government will give it, then how will it be free? How, I have not seen a model in our part of the world which is editorially independent and yet financed by the state. I have not seen it. And I do not believe that I will see such a, I mean, the point is you have to be.
कोई उपाय नहीं है.
आप मुझे बताइए कि आपके पीटी में या हमारे दूरदर्शन में कितना आपको ऑनेस्टी मिलता है कंटेंट का? How often is PTV or Doordarshan able to criticize their governments?
Olive, what is your experience? What is your experience? One thing which Barkha raised and which is very true for Pakistan also, that people are obsessed with politics, totally obsessed with politics.
Yes.
Even though there is no democracy, but obsession with politics
there
continues.
Is no democracy?
Even when. And the other thing is about the public interest broadcasting. What is your experience and how does it happen in France or Sweden?
I mean, public service is, we should have to define, because in Sweden, in France, I mean, in Sweden, the public service is licensed, finance, there is a fee. In France, you have advertisement also on the public service. So it's a kind of middle way. In both countries, public service is, even it's,
Is there state media in both countries? The state media, government media?
Not that way, no. It's not that way. But I mean, they are competing about the audience.
Yes,
because their mission is to...
And the share of politics in the content.
Politics,
how much politics dominate the coverage of the media?
I mean, people are just mad about politics like here, yes?
Yes.
It's the same.
It's the same.
Yes, of course.
About the same. I think we have just about 17, 18 minutes for the audience to take part in this. And again, if there are any questions, I see three hands raised. And
four.
And
five.
Five. Okay. Let's begin. And if you want to identify the panelists that you are asking question, please do that. Chale, inko de de pehle. Acha, ye kuch, the mics are, acha. Ha. So ye.
That just comes from being a TV journalist. I know how to speak it.
Barkha ko aata hai ke mic kitne kareeb hoton ke hona chahiye. Jaise wo jo pop singers hote hai na, bilkul laga ke.
मेरा सवाल बरखा दत्त से है.
जी,
पाकिस्तान में तो ये देखा गया है कि जो इलेक्ट्रॉनिक मीडिया है, न्यूज़ का नेगेटिव जो एस्पेक्ट है उसको बार बार रिपीट करके दिखाते हैं, वो बाकी न्यूज़ का जो पॉजिटिव एस्पेक्ट है वो बहुत थोड़ा सा दिखाते हैं. क्या इंडिया में वैसा ही है कि इलेक्ट्रॉनिक मीडिया बार बार दिखाता है, पॉजिटिव कम दिखाता है?
देखिए, हमारी प्रोफेशन के बारे में बहुत कुछ क्रिटिसाइज करने को है, लेकिन ये बात मुझे समझ नहीं आती. हमसे बार बार पूछा जाता है कि आप लोग पॉजिटिव क्यों नहीं दिखाते, पर हम पब्लिक रिलेशंस पीपल तो नहीं है ना. हमारा काम है कि जो गलत होता है, जब कुछ खराब होता है, जब कुछ ट्रेजेडी होती है, कोई करप्शन होता है, कोई स्कैंडल होता है, कोई इनजस्टिस होती है, हमारा काम है उसको आवाज़ देना. That doesn't mean we never tell stories of hope. That never doesn't mean we don't tell stories of amity. But I do believe that we are not here to We're not here for feel-good news. The job of a journalist is to chase all that is wrong, or to be a bridge between the viewer and any place you are in. If you're in a remote place, you're covering a war, a riot, a tsunami. So I'm not sure about this.
Yes, give the lal kameez. Assalamu
alaikum. My question is to for Miss Barkha Dutt. First of all, thank you very much for coming.
Thank
and,
you.
We are thanking to this KLF for inviting you to Pakistan.
Thank you. And thank you so much. Pleasure to be here.
And my question is, you said that why we don't choose the content.
Why do you not reject content that you don't respect? You know, a lot of people, ye hamare desh mein bhi hota hai, they don't respect that television content, but they watch it. It creates a real big problem for the rest of us who don't believe in that kind of journalism.
But what I want to say, that the situation comes when we see that our media is so weak, you know, so weak to resist because of the greed or because of so many other things.
Resist but, what?
For example, if you remember in 2013, the paid content, a paid TVC was being played on the all TV channels from channel 1 to channel 99. Secondly, that from channel 1 to channel 99, that every channel which was playing that paid TVC was based on the content provided by the government and the money to play it, to show it, provided by the government. But no one resisted, and no one, I mean, the scholars, the authors, the everyone who sits over, no one condemned it.
I'm not really familiar with some of the debates here related to Pakistan media, except that, as I was saying in the morning, I find that a lot of your channels here and a lot of our channels there, I don't know about this paid content thing, I'm not familiar with it, so I can't comment on it. But this deliberate choosing of extreme voices to shout at each other is something I'm very uncomfortable with. But I will still maintain that a lot of that kind of television gets watched and it gets discussed, and it really shrinks the options for the rest of us who don't believe in that kind of journalism.
Assalamu alaikum. For my question to you as well, Barkha, and thank you.
Am I going to take all the questions? That's not fair.
Thank you so much again to come to Pakistan. We really welcome you.
Thank you so much.
My question is that I don't live in Pakistan, so I get to see a lot of Indian news channels as well.
Yes.
And I am really, if I say, embarrassed to be part of the subcontinent where the media is playing such an unbelievably poor role of on both sides. I mean, पहले मुझे लगता था हमारे channels ये करते हैं, but I think Indian channels भी यही करते हैं. दोनों sides पे इतना ज़्यादा hate mongering और इतना ज़्यादा छोटी-छोटी बातों को negative करके और बिल्कुल एक, you know, there is and that's why when somebody like you comes to Pakistan, it's a big thing for us, because there is people-to-people contact, and you see millions of people who are not hate mongers and who are not negative and who are very fairly open about relationships with India as a neighbor and everything. So my question to you specifically is, what iconic journalists like yourself, aap zara sa bhi softer image leti hain Pakistan ke baare mein, to bahut zyada criticism aapko face bhi karni padti hai social media mein. I've seen that. I follow your Twitter account as well. So what can an iconic journalist like you, somebody like Kamran Khan in Pakistan and people like Ghazi Salahuddin, what kind of role can they play to calm things down on both sides, okay? Because aap log shape kar rahe hain narrative Pakistan ke baare mein aur its relationship ke baare mein. So what can you do differently to make things normalize between these two neighbors who have to coexist for the entire life?
Okay, so I agree with you that there is a lot of shrillness and a lot of warmongering that goes on both of our channels. And you know, ye sirf India mein problem nahi hai, yahan bhi problem hai. Ek zamana hota tha, main yahan aati thi, I was a regular, matlab dost hai sare, television anchors sab bulate the. Now nobody wants to get locked into the tamasha of an India Pakistan television debate.
Takra.
Nobody. Matlab main jaati hi nahi. I rather talk to people like this. Kyunki main dekhti hoon ki everybody itna polarized ho gaya hai ye conversation ki कुछ भी, मतलब everybody's defensive, या everybody's aggressive, या everybody's defensive. कोई अपने दिल से बात ही नहीं करता, कोई balance तरीके से बात ही नहीं करता. अब मैंने सुबह बोला यहाँ पर, और मुझे दोनों बात सही लगती हैं. मुझसे अनुपम खेर के बारे में पूछा गया, मैंने कहा it's a big disappointment that he's not here. I really wish that he'd got his visa instantly so that he was here and all of you maybe could argue with him, he could argue with you. लेकिन ये मुझे लगता है, I wish he hadn't been denied a visa. लेकिन मुझे ये भी लगता है कि हम में से जो भारत से यहाँ आए हैं, we are no less proud Indians because we're here. Whether it's Salman Khurshid is in the audience, there's me, there's any number of people. तो लोगों को एक गलत फहमी हो गई है that if you love, you know, if you're a proud patriot of your country, if you admire your military as I certainly do mine, you can't be a spokesperson for peace. Or if you're a spokesperson for peace, then yehi hoga ki aap bas vaga pe khade mombattiyan hila rahe hain. Arey nahi yaar, hum bhi, matlab hamara bhi dimag hai. We are realistic. We are pragmatic people. There are things about Pakistan that disturb me. There are things about my own country that disturb me. I think the only thing we can do is to not seek populism. I keep coming back to this, this need to be liked by the mass. ये एक बहुत dangerous चीज़ है, ये एक बहुत cowardly चीज़ है. ये मुझे लगता है कि dogma से दूर रहना और populism से दूर रहना हम दोनों देशों के लिए बहुत ज़रूरी है.
May I intervene? Irrespective of what you say, and which is true that there are harsh voices and they choose most extreme points of view, but isn't there something inherent in the media to unsettle you, to disturb you?
What disturbs me is the absence of conversations that are in the center. I as an individual, I do not belong to the right of the ideological or the political spectrum, and I do not belong to the left. I am not a neoliberal, I am not a Marxist, I am not a jingoist, I am not a peacenik. I don't like these labels. What disturbs me in the media is the inability to speak without labels.
Yes, can we pose the same question to both Farhan and Olivia? Is it not inherent in the very medium that it disturbs you, that unsettles you, creates conflicts in your mind? Is the media, as a message, going back to McLuhan, if the medium is the message, is the message itself not the problem?
Or is the medium itself not the problem?
Media.
Is what you're asking.
Oh yes. What do you think? Well, Farhan, would you?
Barkha is going to intensely disagree with me.
I'm already shaking my head in anticipation.
But I just think, look, from the time that I started out in journalism, which I said earlier on was a difficult period in Pakistan's history, I think the media has evolved in ways that I'm not very comfortable with. And whether it should be self-regulation or better than that, some mechanism to reinstate the authority and independence of the editor, because across Pakistan there are far too few independent editors left. Something has to be done somewhere, because it's right now, I don't want to get into naming names, but there are some news organizations where people are, you know, effectively free for all. There are no editorial sort of discussions or again, don't want to use the word controls in a negative sense, but there has to be some sense of responsibility, and I see plenty of that. For example, many news organizations around the world, typically in print, use a jargon known as lawyer. Copies have to be passed through a full-time lawyer just to make certain that it falls within acceptable legal bounds. That doesn't happen here.
But can I just say one thing?
Organizations have to be more responsible.
But mediums do not dumb down content. People do. There's no point blaming the medium. When I started television, I'm one of the first few people in my country who's a first generation television journalist. Otherwise, most people had moved from print into TV. And people said, TV is inherently a less intelligent medium. I don't think so. I think people are intelligent or people are not intelligent. People dumb down content. Mediums don't. Why do we think some mediums are shallow? Mediums are not shallow, people are.
Mm-hmm. Olivia, what do you think about these views, that is media itself in the context of how, the digital media has spread? Was it not inevitable with this spread to have the results that we have? Could it have been otherwise?
I mean, I don't know how to answer such a question, because the media are so different. They have been answering these questions if you put all the media on the same level, you don't get a good picture of the situation.
So let's go back to
I want to say one thing, because I happen to be one of those people from here. I go on a lot of Indian talk shows, and what I have noticed is a lot of people have commented to me in the last 1 year, why don't you ever raise your voice when you're answering questions? I don't. And it has reached a point that even, like, other than Times Now, I think I've been on all the major channels. they listen. As long as you have something substantial to say, and as long as you're not going into the blame game, if they are asking you a legit question, now I'm talking about Indians to us, if they are asking you a question, instead of saying, oh, but you did that, you did this, that happened, this happened, why do, we're not talking about that right now. So I have actually been able to say, I don't ever talk against Pakistan, but I've actually managed to say things to the anchors, and they listen. And some of them are very right-wing, jingoistic anchors. What I'm trying to say is, again, to her, that media can play a big role, because it all depends on the anchor and what they want you to say, how they want the debate to go.
But can I ask you who these people are who do appear on Times Now? We're all very curious. We who are these who? Pakistanis are who go are every we? Day to be shouted at. I really would, if you could share.
You know, I have.
I asked, always see two generals sitting there.
I've asked a couple of them, and they say, oh, but don't you see what we do to Arnab Goswami? I said, no, you don't. All he manages to do is yell at you, tell you to shut up, actually like shut up, and this is rubbish and nonsense. And they say, no, we do the same thing to
let's
him.
Let's have another question. There, Ayla.
I just thought ke state media ko you've sort of brushed it away. Can we look at NPR as a उधर भी अमेरिका में भी उतनी जहालत है जितनी probably यहाँ पे how do they deal with this state media that NPR is a state owned organization.
But the political culture is different, right? I mean, National Public Radio, NPR.
That's a point that
the political culture is different. We have to acknowledge that.
Much would depend on what a society is, the level of its
openness.
Education, the kind of culture that it has, the freedoms that it has, and that would have an impact on the kind of media that you have. Because when I watch discussions on BBC, I can see that it is how they have been brought up. It is how they exchange their views. It's the quality of their upbringing and their the education that they have.
I don't know who wants to take that, but it's also the political culture. You see, it's not about...
Yes.
NPR works in the United States of America because there is a very, very strong emphasis, A, on free speech, and B, the American president will come and even do a show for YouTube. In our countries, we struggle to get big politicians. People have egos, they don't want to do debates, they'll say, oh, please come, you interview us one-on-one, they don't want to take another point of view. Our political culture is not oriented towards being so informal and open and accessible.
Mm-hmm. Now, I think we will have two more questions. We'll draw the lots or what? Chale, aap ek aap pushi.
Well, my name is Nasir, and I'm
here. Okay. Question Barkha se to nahi hai na?
it's to all of you.
Achha.
But especially I want to point out to Barkha because she is center of attention. This is to you, ma'am. And actually, we have a lot of Twitter following you, and I think and there is a code word, and if you just want to wrangle a journalist, if you want to point out a journalist of you are point out his flaws, you just give a code word, lifafa culture in
that is our, in Pakistan we used to use it.
I mean, I think what is your take on the wrong journalism? It's not about all the journalists are transparent.
No,
what do you take
of course,
on
but what there is no profession where everyone is good. They are all politicians honest? Are all journalists great? Are all lawyers fine people? No. Every profession has some bad apples. Every profession also takes a little bit of time to institutionalize what is acceptable, what is not. I think private television in both of our countries is very young. The media is still exploding. Strangely, one of the things that's happened in both our countries is usually competition is meant to improve quality. I would say in both our countries, competition has actually led to a decline in quality. Yes. But that doesn't mean that we can run away from the fact that that competition is here to stay. So let's not pretend that we can go back to some old sepia tinted days of there were only two channels, tab bahut acha hota tha. Nahi, tab bhi bahut acha nahi hota tha. The fact is the media is constantly changing, consumers are changing, there are new challenges, technology changes you. So lafafa journalism, aapke yahan, yahan, humare yahan bhi, humare election commission ne paid news ki analysis ki thi. Ye har profession mein hota hai ki there are gaps in ethical standards. And then there is a pushback from viewers, from institutional bodies, and you know, I don't think we should tarnish professions. I find that very lazy media bashing.
Shelley,
I hope the last question is not going to be to me now. I've been answering questions all day.
The last question, and I had promised to Olivia that there will be a question for him.
Yeah.
No.
Yes.
Mr. Khurshid is here. Now he's going to answer some questions.
My name is Anam. Up front, my apologies. You know, my question is once again directed towards Burqa. There is a recent. My apologies. Since so much is happening in India, I have to refer to those developments. Mm-hmm. Lot of groups have emerged in India, which have tried to stifle free expression. You have very rightly pointed out in your book as well. How scary is it for you as a journalist not to say few things in today's India?
मैंने सुबह इसका जवाब बहुत लेंथ पे दिया था. Probably you were not there. I said that I believe that there is a certain hyperbolic quality to this. ये आपको impression है कि हम अपना mind नहीं speak करते. ये बिल्कुल ठीक नहीं है. I have never held back from saying what I believe. It may get me gullies on social media, but that's about the only casualty that one has to make for speaking your mind. So, okay, wo gali dete rahe. Baki jo maine subah bola tha, main dobara repeat kar deti hu. Mujhse baar baar pucha jata hai ki aapke desh mein jo tolerance debate chal rahi hai, uske baare mein aap kya kahenge? Aur maine subah bhi bola, main dobara bhi repeat karti hu. I don't accept that India is less tolerant today. I don't accept that. I believe that the tolerance debate has been politicized by both overstatement and understatement on both sides of our political spectrum. Jahan mujhe intolerance dikhti hai, wo bas isi mein dikhti hai ki jab hum conversation karte hain, that intolerance is for another point of view. The intolerance is not religious. The intolerance is your and my ability to talk to each other and listen to each other if we disagree. That is the only intolerance that worries me.
Thank you, Burqa. And before we conclude, आपसे एक बात पूछनी है. Was there a Burqa tweet during this program?
Was there a
Burqa tweet during this program?
No. But I will be tweeting
okay.
after
thank
this.
Thank you
program.
So much. And I must thank my panelist Olivia, Burqa, and Farhan.
Thank you. So
and thank you for being such a good audience.
Thank
Shukriya
you.
Shukriya bahut.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next session in this hall will be the Mushaira at 6:45 p.m. Thank you.